disposition. It is not the occasional member of its species that is a manhunter. All are manhunters, but they do not confine their foraging to man alone, for there is no flesh of fish within Blue Star that they will not eat with relish in their constant efforts which they make to furnish their huge carcasses with sufficient sustenance to maintain their mighty thews. Upon one side of the doomed pair, the Thag bellowed in advance. Upon the other, Tarag, the frightful, crept toward them with gaping mouth and dripping veins. The man seized the spears, handing one of them to the woman. At the sound of the roaring of the tiger, the bull's bellowing became a veritable frenzy of rageful noise. Never in my life had I heard such an infernal din as the two brutes made, and to think that it was all lost upon the hideous reptiles for whom the show was staged. The Thag was charging now from one side, and the Tarag from the other. The two puny things standing between them seemed already lost, but at the very moment that the beasts were upon them, the man grasped his companion by the arm, and together they leaped to one side, while the frenzied creatures came together like locomotives in collision. There ensued a battle royal for which sustained and frightful ferocity transcends the power of imagination or description. Time and again the colossal bull tossed the enormous tiger high into the air, but each time that the huge cat touched the ground, he returned to the encounter with apparently undiminished strength and seemingly increased ire. For a while, the man and woman busied themselves only with keeping out of the way of the two creatures, but finally I saw them separate and each creep stealthily toward one of the combats. The tiger was now upon the bull's broad back, clinging to the huge neck with powerful fangs, while its long, strong talons ripped the heavy hide into shreds and ribbons. For a moment, the bull stood bellowing and quivering with pain and rage, its cloven hoofs widespread, its tail lashing viciously from side to side, and then in a mad orgy of bucking, it went careening about the arena in frenzied attempt to unseat its rending rider. It was with difficulty that the girl avoided the first mad rush of the wounded animal. All its efforts to rid itself of the tiger seemed futile until, in desperation, it threw itself upon the ground, rolling over and over. A little of this so disconcerted the tiger, knocking its breath from it, I imagine, that it lost its hold, and then, quick as a cat, the great Thag was up again, and it buried those mighty horns deep in the Tarag's abdomen, pinning him to the floor of the arena. The great cat clawed at the shaggy head until eyes and ears were gone, and naught but a few strips of ragged, bloody flesh remained upon the skull. Yet through all the agony of that fearful punishment, the Thag still stood motionless, pinning down his adversary. And then the man leaped in, seeing that the blind bull would be the less formidable enemy, and ran his spear through the Tarag's heart. As the animal's fierce clawing ceased, the bull raised his gory, sightless head, and with a horrid roar ran headlong across the arena. With great leaps and bounds, he came straight toward the arena wall, directly beneath where we sat, and an accident carried him in one of his mighty springs completely over the barrier to the midst of the slaves and sagas just in front of us. Swinging his bloody horns from side to side, the beast cut a wide swath before him, straight upward toward our seats. Before him, slaves and guerrilla men fought a mad stampede to escape the menace of the creature's death agonies. For such only could that frightful charge have been. Forgetful of us, our guards joined in the general rush for the exits, many of which pierced the wall of the amphitheater behind us. Perry, Gack, and I became separated in the chaos which reigned for a few moments after the beast cleared the wall of the arena, each intent upon saving his own hide. I ran to the right, passing several exits, choked with the fear-mad mob that were battling to escape. One would have thought that an entire herd of Thags was loose behind them, rather than a single blinded dying beast, but such is the effect of panic upon a crowd. Freedom. Once out of the direct path of the animal, fear of it left me, but another emotion has quickly gripped me. Hope of escape that the demoralized condition of the guards made possible for the instance. I thought of Perry, and but for the hope that I might better encompass his release, if myself free, I should have put the thought of freedom from me at once. As it was, I hastened on toward the right, searching for an exit toward which no sagas were fleeing. And at last I found it, a low, narrow aperture leading into a dark corridor. Without thought of the possible consequence, I darted into the shadows of the tunnel, feeling my way along through the gloom for some distance. The noises of the amphitheater had grown fainter and fainter until now all was as silent as the tomb about me. Faint light filtered from above through occasional ventilating and lighting tubes, but it was scarce sufficient to enable my human eyes to cope with the darkness, and so I was forced to move with extreme care, feeling my way along step by step with a hand upon the wall beside me. Presently the light increased, and a moment later, to my delight, I came upon a flight of steps leading upward, at the top of which the brilliant light of the noonday sun shone through an opening in the ground. Cautiously, I crept up the stairway to the tunnel's end, and peering out, I saw the broad plain of future before me, the numerous lofty granite towers which marked several entrances to the subterranean city were all in front of me. Behind, the plain stretched level and unbroken to the nearby foothills. I had come to the surface, then beyond the city. My chances for escape seemed much enhanced. My first impulse was to await darkness before attempting to cross the plain. So deeply implanted are habits of thought, but of a sudden I recollected the perpetual noonday brilliance which envelopes Pellucidar, and with a smile I stepped forth into the daylight. Rank grass, waist high, grows upon the plain of future, the gorgeous flowering grass of the inner world, each particular blade of which is tipped with a tiny five-pointed blossom, brilliant like stars of varying colors that twinkle in the green foliage to add still another charm to the weird yet lovely landscape. But then the only aspect which attracted me was the distant hills in which I hoped to find sanctuary, and so I hastened on, trampling the myriad beauties beneath my hurrying feet. Perry says that the force of gravity is less upon the surface of the inner world than upon that of the outer. He explained it all to me once, but I was never particularly brilliant in such matters, and most of it had escaped me. As I recall it, the difference is due in some part to the contraction of that portion of the Earth's crust directly opposite the spot upon the face of Pellucidar which one's calculations are being made. Be that as it may, it always seemed to me that I moved with greater speed and agility within Pellucidar than upon the outer surface. There was a certain airy lightness of step that was most pleasing, and a feeling of bodily detachment which I could only compare with that occasionally experienced in dreams. And as I caught across future's flower bespangled plain, at time I seemed almost to fly, though how much of that sensation was due to Perry's suggestion, how much to actuality, I am sure I do not know. The more I thought of Perry, the less pleasure I took in my newfound freedom. There could be no liberty for me within Pellucidar unless the old man shared it with me, and only the hope that I might find some way to encompass his release kept me from turning back to future. Just how I was to help Perry, I could scarce imagine, but I hoped that some fortuitous circumstances might solve the problem for me. It was quite evident, however, that little less than a miracle could aid me, for what could I accomplish in this strange world, naked and unarmed? It was even doubtful that I could retrace my steps to future, should I once pass beyond view of the plain. And even were that possible, what aid could I bring to Perry, no matter how far, I wondered. The case looked more and more hopeless the longer I viewed it. Yet with a stubborn persistency, I forged ahead toward the foothills. Behind me, no sound of pursuit developed. Before me, I saw no living thing. It was as though I moved through a dead and forgotten world. I have no idea, of course, how long it took me to reach the limit of the plain, but at last I entered the foothills, following a pretty little canyon upward toward the mountains. Beside me followed the laughing brooklet, hurrying upon its noisy way down to the silent sea. In its quieter pools, I discovered many small fish, of 4 or 5 pound weight, I should imagine. In appearance, except as to size and color, they were not unlike the whale of our own seas. As I watched them playing about, I discovered not only that they suckled their young, but that at intervals they rose to the surface to breathe, as well as to feed upon certain grasses and a strange scarlet lichen which grew upon the rocks just above the waterline. It was this last habit that gave me the opportunity I craved to capture one of these herbivorous cetaceans. That is what Perry calls them, and make as good a meal as one can raw, warm-blooded fish. But I had become rather used by this time to eating the food in its natural state, though I still balked on the eyes and entrails, much to the amusement of Gack, to whom I always passed these delicacies. Crouching beside the brook, I waited until one of the diminutive purple whales rose to nibble at the long grasses which overhung the water. And then, like the beast of prey that man really is, I sprang upon my victim, appeasing my hunger while he yet wriggled to escape. Then I drank from the clear pool, and after washing my hands and face, continued my fight. Above the source of the brook, I encountered a rugged climb to the summit of a long ridge. Beyond was a steep declivity to the shore of a placid inland sea, upon the quiet surface which lay several beautiful islands. The view was charming in the extreme, and as no man or beast was to be seen that might threaten my newfound liberty, I slid over the edge of the bluff, and half sliding, half falling, dropped into the delightful valley, the very aspect of which seemed to offer a haven of peace and security. The gentle, sloping beach along which I walked was thickly strewn with strangely shaped, colored shells, some empty, others still housing as varied a multitude of mollusks as ever might have drawn out their sluggish lives along the silent shores of the antediluvian seas of the outer crust. As I walked, I could not but compare myself with the first man of that other world, so complete the solitude which surrounded me, so primal and untouched the virgin wonders and beauties of adolescent nature. I felt myself a second Adam, wending my lonely way through the childhood of a world, searching for my Eve, and at that thought there arose before my mind's eye the exquisite outlines of a perfect face, surmounted by a loose pile of wondrous raven hair. As I walked, my eyes were beamed upon the beach, so that it was not until I had come quiet upon it that I discovered that which shattered all my beautiful dream of solitude and safety and peace and primal overlordship. The thing was a hollow log drawn upon the sands, and in the bottom of it lay a crude paddle. The rude shock of awakening to what doubtless might prove some new form of danger was still upon me, when I heard a rattling of loose stones from the direction of the bluff, and turning my eyes in that direction, I beheld the author of the disturbance, a great copper-colored man running rapidly toward me. There was that in the haste which he came, which seemed quite sufficiently menacing, so that I did not need the added evidence of brandishing spear and scowling face to warn me that I was in no safe position. But whether to flee was indeed a momentous question. The speed of the fellow seemed to preclude the possibility of escaping him upon the open beach. There was but a single alternative, the rude skiff, and with the serenity which equaled his, I pushed the thing into the sea, and as it floated, gave a final shudder, and clambered in over the end. A cry of rage rose from the owner of the primitive craft, and an instant later, his heavy stone-tipped spear grazed my shoulder and buried itself in the bow of the boat beyond. Then I grasped the paddle, and with feverish haste, urged the awkward, wobbly thing out upon the surface of the sea. A glance over my shoulder showed me that the copper-colored one had plunged in after me and was swimming rapidly in pursuit. His mighty strokes bade fair to close up the distance between us in short order, for at best I could make but slow progress with my unfamiliar craft, with snow stubbornly in every direction but that which I desired to follow, so that fully half my energy was expended in turning its blunt prow back into the course. I had covered some 100 yards from the shore when it became evident that my pursuer must grasp the stern of the skiff within the next half dozen strokes. In a frenzy of despair, I bent to the grandfather of all paddles in a hopeless effort to escape. And still the skipper giant behind me gained and gained. His hand was reaching upward for the stern when I saw a sleek, sinuous body shoot from the depths below. The man saw it too, and the look of terror that overspread his face assured me that I need have no further concern as to him, for the fear of certain death was in his look. Then about him coiled the great slimy folds of a hideous monster of what prehistoric deep, mighty serpent of the sea, with fanged jaws and darting port tongue, with bulging eyes and bony protuberances upon head and snout that formed short, stout horns. As I looked at the hopeless struggle, my eyes met those of the doomed man, and I could have sworn that in his I saw an expression of hopeless appeal. But whether I did or no, there swept through me a sudden compassion for the fellow. He was indeed a brother man, and that he might have killed me with pleasure had he caught me was forgotten in the extremity of his danger. Unconsciously I had ceased paddling as the serpent rose to engage my pursuer. So now the skiff still drifted close beside the two. The monster seemed to be but playing with his victim before he closed his awful jaws upon him and dragged him down to his dark den beneath the surface to devour him. The huge snake-like body coiled and uncoiled about its prey. The hideous gaping jaw snapped in the victim's face. The forked tongue, lightning light, ran in and out upon the copper skin. Nobly the giant battled for his life, beating with the stone hatchet against the bony armor that covered the frightful carcass. But for all the damage he inflicted, he might as well have struck with his open palm. At last I could endure no longer to sit supinely while a fellow man was dragged down to a horrible death by that repulsive reptile. Embedded in the prow of the skiff lay the spear that had been cast after me by him who I suddenly desired to save. With a wrench I tore it loose, and standing upright in the wobbly log, drove it with all the strength of my two arms straight into the gaping jaws of the hydrophidian. With a loud hiss, the creature abandoned its prey to turn upon me, but the spear embedded in its throat prevented it from seizing me, though it came near to overturning the skiff in its mad efforts to reach me. The Mahar Temple. The aborigine, apparently uninjured, climbed quickly into the skiff, and seizing the spear with me, helped to hold off the infuriated creature. Blood from the wounded reptile was now crimsoning the water about us, and soon from the weakening struggles it became evident that I inflicted a death wound upon him. Presently its efforts to reach us ceased entirely, and with a few convulsive movements it turned upon its back, quite dead. And then there came to me a sudden realization of the predicament in which I had placed myself. I was entirely within the power of the savage man whose skiff I had stolen. Still clinging to the spear, I looked into his face to find him scrutinizing me intently. And there we stood for some several minutes, each clinging tenaciously to the weapon, the while we gazed in stupid wonderment at each other. What was in his mind, I do not know, but my own was merely the question as to how soon the fellow would recommence hostilities. Presently he spoke to me, but in a tongue which I was unable to translate. I shook my head in an effort to indicate my ignorance of his language, at the same time addressing him in the bastard tongue that sagas used to converse with the human slaves of the Mahars. To my delight, he understood and answered me in the same jargon. "What do you want of my spear?" he asked. "Only to keep you from running it through me," I replied. "I will not do that," he said, "for you have just saved my life." And with that, he released his hold upon it and squatted down in the bottom of the skiff. "Who are you?" he continued, "and from what country do you come?" I too sat down, laying the spear between us, tried to explain how I came to Blue Star and where from, but it was as impossible for him to grasp or believe the strange tale I told him, as I fear it is for you upon the outer crust to believe in the existence of the inner world. To him it seemed quite ridiculous to imagine that there was another world far beneath his feet, peopled by beings familiar to himself, and he laughed uproariously the more he thought upon it. But it was ever thus. That which has never come within the scope of our really pitifully meager world experience cannot be. Our finite minds cannot grasp that which may not exist in accordance with the conditions which obtain about us. From the outside of the insignificant grain of dust which winds its tiny way among the boulders of the universe, the speck of moisture we so proudly call the world. So I gave it up and asked him about himself. He said he was a Mazop, and that his name was Ja. "Who are the Mazops?" I asked. "Where did they live?" He looked at me in surprise. "I might indeed believe that you are from another world," he said, "for who of Pellucidar could be so ignorant? The Mazops live upon the island of the seas, and so far as I ever have heard, no Mazops live elsewhere, and no others than Mazops dwell upon islands. But of course it may be different in other far distant lands. I do not know. At any rate, in this sea and those nearby, it is true that only people of my race inhabit the islands. We are fishermen, though we be great hunters as well, often going to the mainland in search of the game that is scarce upon all but the larger islands. And we are warriors also," he added proudly. "Even the sagas of the Mahars fear us. Once, when Pellucidar was young, the sagas were wont to capture us for slaves, as they do the other men of Pellucidar. It is handed down from father to son among us that this is so, but we fought so desperately and slew so many sagas, and those of us that were captured killed so many Mahars in their own cities that at last they learned that it were better to leave us alone. And later came the time that the Mahars became too indolent even to catch their own fish, except for amusement. And then they needed us to supply their wants, and so a truce was made between the races. Now they give us certain things which we are unable to produce in return for the fish that we catch, and the Mazops and the Mahars live in peace. The great ones even come to our islands. It is there, far from the prying eyes of their own sagas, that they practice their religious rites in the temples they have built there with our assistance. If you live among us, you will doubtless see the manner of their worship, which is strange indeed and most unpleasant for the poor slaves they bring to take part in it." As Josh talked, I had an excellent opportunity to inspect him more closely. He was a huge fellow, standing, I should say, 6 feet 6 or 7 inches, well-developed and of a coppery red, not unlike that of our own North American Indian, nor was his features dissimilar to theirs. He had the aquiline nose found among many of the higher tribes, the prominent cheekbones and black hair and eyes, but his mouth and lips were better molded. All in all, Jai was an impressive and handsome creature, and he talked well too, even though in the miserable makeshift language we were compelled to use. During our conversation, Jai had taken the paddle and was propelling his skiff with vigorous strokes toward a large island that lay some half mile from the mainland. The skill with which he handled his crude and awkward craft led to my deepest admiration, since it had been so short a time before that I had made such pitiful work of it. As we touched the pretty level beach, Jai leaped out and I followed him. Together we dragged the skiff far up into the bushes that grew beyond the sand. "We must hide our canoes," explained Jai, for the Mesops of Luna are always at war with us and would steal them if they found them. He nodded toward an island farther out at sea, and at so great a distance that it seemed but a blur hanging in the distant sky. The upward curve of the surface of the blue star was constantly revealing impossible to the surprised eyes of the outer earthly. To see land and water curving upward in the distance until it seemed to stand on edge where it melted into the distant sky, and to feel that seas and mountains hung suspended directly above one's head required such a complete reversal of the perceptive and reasoning faculties as almost to stupefy one. No sooner have we hidden the canoe than Jai plunged into the jungle, presently emerging into a narrow but well-defined trail which wound hither and thither much after the manner of the highways of all primitive folk. But there was one peculiarity about this Mesop trail which I was later to find distinguished them from all other trails that I ever have seen within or without the earth. It would run out plain and clear and well defined to end suddenly in the midst of a tangle of matted jungle. Then Jai would turn directly back in his tracks for a little distance, spring into a tree, climb through it to the other side, drop onto a fallen log, leap over a low bush, and alight once more upon a distinct trail which he would follow back for a short distance, only to turn directly about and retrace his steps until after a mile or less, this new pathway ended as suddenly and mysteriously as the former section. Then he would pass again across some media which would reveal no spore, take up that broken thread of the trail beyond. As the purpose of this remarkable avenue dawned upon me, I could not but admire the native shrewdness of the ancient progenitor of the Mesops, who hit upon this novel plan to throw his enemies from his track and to lay earth toward them in their attempts to follow him to his deepest, deep buried cities. To you of the outer world, it might seem a slow and tortured method of traveling through the jungle, but were you of Blue Star, you would realize that time is no factor where time does not exist. So labyrinth are the windings of these trails, so varied the connecting links and distances which one must retrace one step from the past ends to find them. And a Mesop often reaches man's estate before he is familiar even with those which lead from his own city to the sea. In fact, three-fourths of the education of the young male Mesop consists in familiarizing himself with these jungle avenues, and the status of an adult is largely determined by the number of trails which he can follow upon his own island. The females never learn them, since from birth to death they never leave the clearing in which the village of their nativity is situated, except they will be taken to mate by a male from another village, or captured in war by the enemies of their tribe. After proceeding through the jungle for what must have been upward of 5 miles, we emerged suddenly into a large clearing in the exact center of which stood as strange an appearing village as one might well imagine. Large trees had been chopped down 15 or 20 feet above the ground, and upon the tops of them spherical habitations of woven twigs, mud-covered, had been built. Each ball-like house was surmounted by some manner of carving image which Jai told me indicated the identity of the owner. Horizontal slits 6 inches high, 2 or 3 feet wide, served to emit light and ventilation. The entrances to the houses were through small apertures in the base of the tree, and thence upward by rude ladders through the hollow trunks to the rooms above. The houses varied in size from 2 to several rooms. The largest that I entered was divided into 2 floors and 8 apartments. All about the village between it and jungle lay beautifully cultivated fields in which the Mesops raised such cereals, fruits, and vegetables as they required. Women and children were working in these gardens as we crossed toward the village. At sight of Jai, they saluted differently, but to me they paid not the slightest attention. Among them and about the outer verge of the cultivated area were many warriors. These two saluted Jai, but touching the points of their spears to the ground directly before them. Jai conducted me to a large house in the center of the village, the house with 8 rooms, and taking me up into it, gave me food and drink. There I met his maid, a comely girl with a nursing baby in her arms. Jai told her of how I had saved his life, and she was thereafter most kind and hospitable toward me, even permitting me to hold in her midst a tiny bundle of humanity whom Jai told me would one day rule the tribe, for Jai, it seemed, was the chief of the community. We had eaten and rested, and I had slept, much to Jai's amusement, for it seemed that he seldom, if ever, did so. And then the red man proposed that I accompany him to the temple of the Mahars, which lay not far from his village. We are not supposed to visit it, he said, but the great ones cannot hear, and if we keep well out of sight, they need never know that we have been there. For my part, I hate them and always have, but the other chieftains of the island think it best that we continue to maintain the amicable relations which exist between the two races. Otherwise, I should like nothing better than to leave my warriors amongst the hideous creatures and exterminate them. Blue Star would be a better place to live were there none of them. I wholly concurred in Jai's belief, but it seemed that it might be a difficult matter to exterminate the dominant race of Blue Star. Thus conversing, we followed the intricate trail toward the temple, which we came upon in a small clearing surrounded by enormous trees, familiar to those which must have flourished upon the outer crust during the Carboniferous Age. Here was a mighty temple of hewn rock, built in the shape of a rough oval with rounded roof, in which were several large openings. No doors or windows were visible in the sides of the structure, nor was there need of any, except one entrance for the slaves, since, as Jai explained, the Mahars flew to and fro from their place of ceremony, so entering and leaving the building by means of the apertures in the roof. But, added Jai, there is an entrance near the base of which even the Mahars know nothing. Come, and he led me across the clearing and about the end to a pile of loose rocks which lay against the foot of the wall. Here he removed a couple of large boulders, revealing a small opening which led straight within the building. Or so it seemed, though, as I entered after Jai, I discovered myself in a narrow place of extreme darkness. We are within the outer wall, said Jai. It is hollow. Follow me closely. The red man groped ahead a few paces and then began to ascend a primitive ladder familiar to that which leads from the ground to the upper stories of his house. We ascended for some 40 feet when the interior of the space between the walls commenced to grow lighter, and presently we came opposite an opening in the inner wall which gave us an obstructive view of the entire interior of the temple. The lower floor was an enormous tank of clear water in which numerous hideous Mahars swam lazily up and down. Artificial islands of granite rock dotted this artificial sea, and upon several of them I saw men and women like myself. What are the human beings doing here, I asked. Wait and you shall see, replied Jai. They are to take a leading part in the ceremonies which will follow the advent of the queen. You may be thankful that you are not upon the same side of the wall as they. Scarcely had he spoken when we heard a great fluttering of wings above, and a moment later a long procession of the frightful reptiles of Pellucidar winged slowly and majestically through the large central opening in the roof and circled in stately manner about the temple. There were several Mahars first, and then at least 20 awe-inspiring pterodactyls, Thipdars, they are called within Pellucidar. Behind these came the queen, flanked by other Thipdars, as she had been when she entered the amphitheater at Future. 3 times they wheeled about the interior of the oval chamber to settle finally upon the damp, cold boulders that fringed the outer edge of the pool. In the center of one side, the largest rock was reserved for the queen, and here she took her place, surrounded by her terrible guard. All lay quiet for several minutes after settling to their places. One might have imagined them in silent prayer. The poor slaves upon the diminutive islands watched the horrid creatures with wide eyes. The men, for the most part, stood erect and stately with folded arms, awaiting their doom. But the women and children clung to one another, hiding behind the males. They are a noble-looking race, these cavemen of Plushtar. And if our progenitors were to stay, the human race of the outer crust has deteriorated rather than improved with the march of the ages. All they lack is opportunity. We have opportunity and little else. Now the queen moved. She raised her ugly head, looking about. Then very slowly she crawled to the edge of her throne and slid noiselessly into the water. Up and down the long tank she swam, turning at the ends as you have seen captive seals turning their tiny tanks, turning upon their backs and diving below the surface. Nearer and nearer to the island she came until at last she remained at rest before the largest, which was directly opposite her throne. Raising her hideous head from the water, she fixed her great round eyes upon the slaves. They were flat and fat and sleek, for they had been brought from a distant Mahar city, where human beings are kept in droves, and bred and fattened as we breed and fatten beef cattle. The queen fixed her gaze upon a plump young maiden. Her victim tried to turn away, hiding her face in her hands and kneeling behind a woman, but the reptile with unblinking eyes stared on with such fixity that I could have sworn her vision penetrated the woman and the girl's arms to reach at last the very center of her brain. Slowly the reptile's head commenced to move to and fro, but the eyes never ceased to bore toward the frightened girl, and then the victim responded. She turned wide, fear-haunted eyes toward the Mahar queen. Slowly she rose to her feet, and then, as though dragged by some unseen power, she moved as one in a trance straight toward the reptile, her glassy eyes fixed upon those of her captor. To the water's edge she came, nor did she even pause, but stepped into the shallows beside the little island. On she moved toward the Mahar, who now slowly retreated as though leading her victim on. The water rose to the girl's knees, and still she advanced, chained by that clammy eye. Now the water was at her waist, now her armpits. Her fellows upon the island looked on in horror, helpless to avert the doom in which they saw a forecast of their own. The Mahar sank now till only the long upper bill and the eyes were exposed above the surface of the water, and the girl had advanced until the end of that repulsive beak was but an inch or two from her face, her horror-filled eyes riveted upon those of the reptile. Now the water passed above the girl's mouth and nose, her eyes and forehead all that showed yet. Still she walked on after the retreating Mahar. The queen's head slowly disappeared beneath the surface, and after it went the eyes of her victim. Only a slow ripple widened toward the shores to mark where the two vanished. For a time all was silent within the temple. The slaves were motionless in terror. The Mahars watched the surface of